student is not above the teacher, nor a servant above his master. It is enough for students to be like their teachers and servants like their masters. If the head of the house had been called Beelzebub, how much more the members of his household? So do not be afraid of them, for there is nothing concealed that will not be disclosed, or hidden that will not be made known. What I tell you in the dark, speak in the daylight. What is whispered in your ear, proclaim from the rooftops. Do not be afraid of those who kill the body but cannot kill the soul. Rather be afraid of the one who can destroy both soul and body in hell. Are not two sparrows sold for a penny? Yet not one of them will fall to the ground outside your Father's care. And even the very hairs of your head are all numbered. So don't be afraid. You are worth more than many sparrows. Whoever acknowledges me before others, I will also acknowledge before my Father in heaven. But whoever disowns me before others, I will disown before my Father in heaven. So do not suppose that I have come to bring peace to the earth. I did not come to bring peace, but a sword. For I have come to turn a man against his father, and a daughter against her mother, a daughter-in-law against her mother-in-law. A man's enemies will be the members of his own household. Anyone who loves their father or mother more than me is not worthy of me. Anyone who loves their son or daughter more than me is not worthy of me. Whoever does not take up their cross and follow me is not worthy of me. Whoever finds their life will lose it, and whoever loses their life for my sake will find it. This is the word of God for us, the people of God. Thanks be to God. You may be seated. In this passage of Scripture, Jesus offers us a deal, a trade. A trade-off, an exchange, a reciprocation. Some would say a covenant, a bargain. I'll scratch your back if you scratch mine. Another name for what we commonly call, at least from the Latin, something that is a quid pro quo. Although we are people that tend to be those who like a quid pro nihilo, something for nothing, a quid pro quo stands for something for something. And Jesus offers two deals, two opportunities, two bargains, two covenants, two ways that we can swap one thing for another, something for something, a quid pro quo. First, he says that we can trade our faith for fear. We are people sometimes that are obsessed, overwhelmed with fear. We're afraid. All we have to do is turn on the nightly news or look down the street or think about our neighbors or look at situations that are around us or even in our own lives, and we can find ourselves as consumed by fear as someone with something much worse than what we have. I almost want to ask how many of you are worriers, but I don't want you to raise your hands, because I think if truth be told, we're all worriers, and that's a smart thing, that's even a wise thing to have concerns. But to become a worrier, to let our fears consume us and not be able to trade our fear for faith, we are not only letting ourselves down, but we're letting Jesus down. For three times in this passage of Scripture, in verse 26, in verse 28, and verse 31, he said, do not fear, do not be afraid, do not fear, do not be afraid. I don't know about you, but I am one of those persons who does worry at times. It's the reason for my beard that you see that I've been secretly growing over these past couple of weeks. You see, in just a few weeks, I'll be traveling to the Congo, first to Alaska, a little bit of Canada, and then to the Congo. I'll be preaching multiple times at the Congo Annual Conference, known as North Katanga, which is a strong church in the United Methodist Church. The bishop there has told me to be prepared to preach three times a day for 7 days to 30,000 people at a time. And the reason I have a beard is because I want to look like my passport. because I don't know anything about what I'm going to be eating or drinking or how I'm going to get from Ireland to Addis Ababa, Ethiopia, and from there to Lubumbashi, Democratic Republic of the Congo, and then I have no clue how I'm going to travel from there for 800 miles to Kamina, Congo. I'm a little worried. And later in the summer, in August, I'll be traveling to the Philippines to help dig a well between these two warring tribes, much of which I've already been told by the bishop in North Katanga is happening in the Congo because the Bantus are not getting along with the Pygmies. Now, I'm not so sure I should be worried about Pygmies, but I'm feeling shorter every minute. So I need to hear these words of Scripture, whether you do or not, but I am assuming, and I know what assuming does, I am assuming that all of us have worries, that all of us have concerns, that all of us have different difficulties, different issues that come our way that cause us to ponder, God, do you really love me? You've heard the story about the fellow who was out walking one day, and he stepped over the edge of the cliff, and as he was falling, he grabbed this branch, and he held on as tightly as he could. And he started yelling, "Help! Help! Is anyone there?" And finally, after yelling for quite some time, he heard a voice and said, "I am here." "Who are you?" "I'm so glad you're here." "I am the Lord." "Oh, Lord, I'm so glad it's you. You'll take care of me." And the Lord says, "Do you trust me?" "Oh, Lord, you know I trust you." And then the Lord says, "Then let go of the branch." And the man hanging on to the limb yells as loudly as he could, Is anybody else up there? Is anybody else up there? No, there's no one else up there. The Lord is up there. But it's so hard for us to look up and look to the Lord when we see all these different things around us that cause us concern and even worry. But the Lord is our reward. It says in the 121st Psalm, where does our help come from? Our help comes from the Lord, the maker of the heaven and the earth. I lift up my eyes to the hills. I look up. There was a Sunday school superintendent at the Sunday school one Sunday who wanted to put the church's Sunday school deposit in the church safe, and he went to the safe, and he couldn't remember the combination on the safe. And so he asked the pastor to come and help him with the problem. So the pastor came, and the pastor immediately turned the dial on the combination lock on the safe, and immediately got two of the numbers correct, and then he lost his place. He couldn't remember the combination, and so he looked up to the ceiling, and as if praying, he then looked back down, and he quickly turned to the other two numbers and opened the safe. And the Sunday school superintendent said, "Pastor, I am so impressed with your level of faith and how great it is." And the pastor said, "Well, it's really not that's much about my faith. You see, we put the numbers to the combination on the ceiling." There are times in my life, whether I'm going to the Philippines or to the Congo, or just down the street, down Richland Avenue or Lawrence, or wherever else in Aiken, that I need to look way past the ceiling. I need to look to God and say, "Lord, only you can help me. Only you can get me through this mess that I'm in. Only you can help me understand this situation. Only you can get me through this valley of the shadow of death. Only you can sustain me." Usually when I go on these mission trips that I've been on, I've been to Mozambique, I've been to Bulgaria, I've been to Nicaragua, I've been to, well, I don't know, the list goes on. But every time I've ever been, I've been with a group. I've had somebody who's got my six, who's got my back, who's with me, who's going through the same sort of thing. But this Congo trip that I know very little about, except that the bishop there invited me to come, and I said yes. been pondering the wisdom of that now. Nobody's going with me. But I'm wrong. God's going with me. As a matter of fact, God's not only going with me, God's already gone ahead of me. God's already there. There's no place that you and I can go, nothing we can go through, that God hasn't already been there ahead of us and is going to make a way so that we can not only survive but thrive. We trust the Lord. I took a course in seminary called Wilderness Experience for Christian Maturity. I thought it sounded intriguing. I like camping. Wilderness Experience for Christian Maturity. I didn't think that through. Wilderness Experience for Christian Maturity. But I found out it wasn't so bad. Because Mike Ford was a classmate of mine. And you might not recognize the name Mike Ford. He's a Presbyterian minister. Mike Ford's father happened to be, and happens to be, Gerald Ford, President Gerald Ford. And so wherever Mike went, he had two Secret Service agents with him. And so when we had the trust fall, which was a way to get us prepared to go on our wilderness experience in the Adirondacks of upstate New York, we had to climb over the top of a tree stump that was as tall as this pulpit and then fall into the arms of our fellow classmates who were taking that same course, but better than that, those two Secret Service agents. I wasn't so trusting in my classmates, but I knew I could trust those Secret Service agents. And we know that we can trust the Lord when we feel like our faith is falling. And our trust level is falling. God's going to always catch us because God loves each one of us. Flights sometimes scare me as well. Part of this trip, we're going to be on some jumbo jets. And part of this trip, I'm assuming that last leg of the trip is going to be in a two-seater getting from Lubumbashi to Kamina, Congo. And I'm not sure which one I'm more afraid of, frankly, because I've been tossed about. And you have too. I always love it when the stewardess, the person on the plane, the airline attendant, stands up and says, "You need to be careful when you open the overhead bin because your luggage may have shifted." Have you ever been attacked by a Tupperware cabinet? You know that one cabinet in your kitchen where you put all the Tupperware, all the plastic pieces, they're not always matched together, and you open that cabinet and it comes out because the last person just stuffed it in there. Well, that's usually what happens to me on airliners. There was a movie some years ago called Airplane, a funny, funny movie. One of the characters' name was Ted Stryker, played by one of my favorite character actors, Bob Hayes, Robert Hayes. An older passenger beside him says to him, "Are you nervous?" And he says, "Yes," with an exclamation point. And then the older passenger said, "First time?" And he replied, "No, I've been nervous lots of times." And I think that's true for most of us, sometimes, especially when flying. There was one pilot who was trying to bring his plane down, an airliner filled with people, and he was about to overshoot the runway, but he didn't want to take back off and go back up and gain altitude, so he decided to do a hard landing, if you've ever been through a hard landing. So he decided to do a hard landing, and it was so hard that when he opened the cabin door after they finally landed so that he could greet people, at least they had, you know, "It's nice to have you on board," or da-da-da-da. He kept his head down. He was really embarrassed about that hard landing until finally the last passenger, this elderly woman with a cane, came walking down the aisle and she said to him, "Sonny, do you mind if I ask you a question?" And the captain replied, "No, ma'am, I don't mind if you ask me a question. What is it?" She said, "Well, what I really want to know, Sonny, is did we land or were we shot down?" Whether we are or not, Jesus gives us a deal, an opportunity, a quid pro quo, something for something. He says, give me your fear. Do not be afraid. Do not be afraid. Do not be afraid. Three times. Whenever you're reading a passage of Scripture, you need to notice how many times it says something, because it's not there by accident. So three times he tells you, and he tells me, and he tells his disciples, do not fear, do not fear, do not fear. Don't be afraid, don't be afraid, don't be afraid. And he uses this marvelous analogy about God knows the number of hairs on your head. With some of us, he's been doing more subtraction than addition. But then he uses the most special analogy that we just sung about, his eyes on a sparrow. He says, aren't two sparrows sold for a small sum of money, a copper coin? But your heavenly Father knows when each one of them falls. That God knows the sparrows, how much more valuable are you than they? I read not long ago that someone with the government counted up how many eagles there are in the U.S. There are said to be 35,000 eagles in the United States. And bald eagles are a majestic creature. But guess how many sparrows there are? I have no clue. Neither does the government. Nobody counts sparrows. In biblical times, they were almost worthless scavengers. And even to this day, even though we might like all kinds of birds, sparrows, nobody counts because they're so plentiful. But here's the deal. We might not know. We might not even care. But God cares. And if God cares, and God knows the number of sparrows, how much more so he cares and loves each of us. So there's nothing that can overcome us. God loves us a lot more than sparrows. God loves us a lot more than sparrows. So one of the deals that he offers in this passage of Scripture is for us to be able to trade in our fear so that we can have more faith. And I pray that you take him up on that deal. And I do too. The second deal that he offers in this passage of Scripture is that he says, if you acknowledge me, I will acknowledge you. That's a quid pro quo. I'll do this for you if you do this for me. What God says, if you acknowledge me, I will acknowledge you. I will recognize you. How many people go through life feeling like they've not achieved much? They feel like they've been overlooked. They feel like they have been left behind. They feel like they have not been acknowledged. I know plenty of people, all of us at different times. I was one of the youngest people in class. I have an October birthday. October the 23rd is my birthday. I was just almost a week from being kicked to the next class, where I would have been the oldest, the biggest, the fastest. But no, I was always picked last because I was the youngest, the shortest, the slowest. Some of you know what I'm talking about. You ever felt overlooked? Underappreciated? Jesus says, I will acknowledge you. I will recognize you if you recognize me. Some of you might remember the book, the movie, The Yearling. Marjorie Rowley wrote the book in the 30s, about the 1880s in Florida. There were two main families in the books, the Baxters and the Forresters. The Baxters were the good Christian people. The Baxters were well thought of. The Baxters were doing okay. The Forresters, on the other hand, if you know anything or remember about the book or the movie, The Yearling, the Forresters were the not-so-good people who lived on the other side of the tracks, literally. One of the Baxter children is the one who is the main person, the main character of the movie and the book, Jody. It's a book, it's a movie about his coming of age, his understanding about acknowledgement, about whether you're recognized, whether or not you matter in the midst of life, and especially its difficulties. Jody learns his through tragedy, primarily. He has a good friend, however, who happened to be a forester, one of those other kind. His friend was named Fodderwing. Now, I don't know what kind of parent it would take to name a child Fodderwing. F-O-D-D-E-R-W-I-N-G, Fodderwing. But it seemed to fit poor Fodderwing Forrester, because Fodderwing was born with multiple handicapping conditions. He didn't feel that good about himself. And others didn't feel that good about him. But here's the thing about the Lord. The Lord always uses those who are handicapped in one way to be extraordinary in other ways. Because our God is a God who's like that. God is a God who uses all of us, whatever our weakness may be, and redeems it for His glory. Well, Fodderwing, with all of his handicaps, the doctors had said about him that he might not live that long. And so it came time, along the way, that his life was nearing its end. Now, Fodderwing did have a way with animals, however. And the way that he showed Jody Baxter his friendship was that Fodderwing had found this baby deer, a fawn, whose mother had been killed or died or something. And he gave that little fawn to Jody Baxter. And Jody Baxter raised that little deer that became a yearling, hence the title of the movie and the book. That became a yearling. And then Fodderwing died. And the yearling had to die too. Fodderwing was so unthought of that no preacher did his funeral. But one of the neighbors just got up at Fodderwing's funeral and said some nice words, said a prayer. This is the prayer. And I quote from Marjorie Rawlings' novel. The prayer went like this. Almighty God, it ain't right for us to say what's right. But if we had been making this boy, we would never have made him with his back bent and his legs crooked. We would have made him straight and tall like his brothers, but somehow you made it up to him. Lord, you gave him away with critters. It comforts us to know that he is in a place where his being bent doesn't matter no more. We would like to think that you have taken that bent back and those crooked legs and straightened them. And Almighty God, if it ain't asking too much, we pray that you will give him some critters to play with. Maybe a few red birds and a squirrel or two. Thy will be done. Amen. Fodderwing and all the Fodderwings, all of us who are Fodderwings, all of us, which means all of us, God loves and wants to recognize that we are His creation and we are special. And there's nothing that diminishes what God sees when God looks at each of us. God sees us perfect. He overlooks our sinfulness because it was nailed to the cross through Jesus. And Jesus forgives us and gives us new starts all the time, because we all matter. But it's a deal that if we acknowledge God, God will acknowledge us. So there are two deals that are offered to you and to me today. In the midst of our tough situations, in the midst of our worries, in the midst of our feeling so insignificant, when we feel like the world is against us, or we're too young, or we're too old, or we're too feeble, or we're too this, or we're too that, or we don't have enough of this and enough of that. Whatever our situation, God offers us two deals that we can trade our fears for faith. Do not be afraid. Do not be afraid. Do not be afraid. And we can trade our feelings of unworthiness and our lack of recognition, because God Almighty says that we are important to Him. I pray that you will accept those deals. And I pray that in the midst of this summertime heat and this lack of rain, this and our lack of that, that you will leave this sanctuary today knowing that Jesus loves you and will provide for you and will take care of you, and there is nothing that can separate you from God's great love that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Let us pray. Lord Jesus, you know our hearts. You know our minds. You know everything about everything. And you know our fears. Help us, Lord, to accept your gracious opportunities, these gracious transactions, these gracious swaps, these wonderful exchanges, these marvelous quid pro quos where there's something for something. Lord, help us today. Hear our prayers. Help us today to trade our fears for faith. Help us today to trade our sense of unworthiness for the recognition that you give us that we're your children. Lord, may we walk forth from this place as new and changed people. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, we pray. Amen.